crossed over the years many times, and I'm excited about what God is doing for you today. Let me give to you a word of encouragement. God is doing something here. Listen, I can tell. This is the first time I've ever stepped foot into this building, and among you, many of you, I maybe know two of you today here, Daniel and Brother Philip, but I can tell. Listen, when we're worshiping together, when we were proclaiming the greatness of God and speaking of His goodness, the Spirit of God was moving. The heavens were joining with us in song. The Spirit of God was convicting people when we spoke of His greatness. We were reminded of our unworthiness. And in those moments, God convicted us of sin and we confessed it to Him. The Spirit of God is moving. So I don't know if you came in here discouraged this morning. I don't know if perhaps you've come in here troubled or with burdened heart. But let me just tell you, God's arm has not been shortened. It hasn't been amputated so that it cannot save. God is doing a powerful work, and it may be imperceivable to you. That is to say, you may not be noticing it quite now. But that's just the way God works. God works in ways that we don't see. He works under the current and moving. And then when we least expect it, perhaps when the night seems darkest, God moves and His Spirit comes in. And I want to encourage you this morning to remain faithful and to remain strong, because God, you wait for the work and the movement of God. God is going to do it. He's faithful and just, and God's going to do that. So I want to encourage you along those lines this morning to be faithful. And speaking of faithfulness, that's precisely what I want us to speak about this morning, or to look at this morning, from 2 Timothy chapter 2. If you have a copy of God's Word, would you turn in your Bible to 2 Timothy chapter 2? We're going to look at just four short verses 3 through 7. We're going to look at what it means to be a faithful servant of God. In the end, all of us will stand before God one day, and we'll give an account, Scripture says. He'll look at our lives, and we'll have to give an account for how we lived, whether we were faithful or unfaithful. This morning, I think it's the conviction of most of you here today to be found faithful when we stand before God. So what does that look like? What is a portrait of someone who's faithful? When we stand before God, what is it that He will be looking for as we speak to Him? As we read in 2 Timothy chapter 2, let's read in verses 3 and following. Paul says to young Timothy, this young pastor in the faith, he says, "Share in suffering as a good soldier of Jesus Christ," or of Christ Jesus. Some of your translations might say, "Share with me," or "Join in suffering with me." It's a joint effort. "Share in suffering as a good soldier of Jesus, of Christ Jesus. No soldier gets entangled in civilian pursuits, since his aim is to please the one who enlisted him. An athlete is not crowned unless he competes according to the rules. And it's the hardworking farmer who ought to receive the first share of the crops. And this, think over what I say, for the Lord will give you understanding into these things." What does it mean to be faithful? What does that look like in my life? The dictionary defines faithfulness as one who is true to his word or his or her promises or vows. Someone who is steady in allegiance or affection. Someone who's reliable or trustworthy. Someone who can be believed to do what they said they were going to do. When Jesus Christ came and He knocked on the heart, the door of your heart, He conscripted you into His service. He made you one of His own, and you became His. And when that happened, you began this pursuit of knowing Christ and living for Him. And God desires for you to finish well, to remain faithful, and to do as He's called you to do. Now, Paul's writing to this young pastor. This pastor was having a hard time, we might understand, because in the first chapter, we read that Paul tells Timothy, "Do not be timid," or "stop being afraid." I don't know if you've ever experienced this, but many times in our lives, we find ourselves consumed with fear. You go to bed at night, and you think of the days, and you think of the things that must be done, and the things you're concerned will happen or won't happen, and you've projected out in your mind how things might turn out, and you're consumed with fear. for Timothy, following Jesus Christ meant that he was going to suffer, and I have a feeling that Timothy had a hard time. He was scared of what people were going to think of him. He was intimidated about the cost it would involve if he really wholeheartedly followed after Jesus Christ. So in the first chapter of 2 Timothy, Paul tells this young man, he says, fan into flame the gift of God that's been given to you through the laying on of my hands. And do not, for God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power. Listen, aren't you glad God has not given you a spirit, that is to say, a presence that is dominated by fear? You don't have to be gripped and bound to the chains of fear. Christ has released you. When Jesus rose from the grave, he offered you victory to join in his resurrection and hope so that you don't have to be afraid. So now Paul comes in the second chapter of Timothy. Paul comes and he says in verse 3, he says, now I'm asking you to join with me in suffering. And that leads us to the first characteristic of a faithful follower, a faithful servant of Christ, and that is endurance. Endurance. Someone say endurance.
Help me out.
Oh, y'all are much more fun than my congregation. I get some feedback from you. That's nice. I appreciate that. Okay. Endurance. It means to remain up underneath. He says, therefore, you must endure hardship. Or it says in verse 3, share in suffering. This word comes from two Greek words. The first one, which means to remain or to live. In fact, it's the same word if someone were to build a house or a dwelling place. If someone were to ask you in Greek, where do you live? You would use the word meno. The other word joined to this word is the word underneath. If you put these things together, you have the idea of suffering is to remain underneath. Do you get what that means? See, most of the time when suffering comes, when hardship comes, when difficulty comes, we want to get out from underneath it. Are you with me? That's how I respond. When the pressures come, when the difficulties come and they begin to weigh us down, I want to get out. But if you're a faithful follower of Jesus Christ and you're suffering because you are true to the Word of God and true to the gospel, you must remain up underneath that difficulty until the time when God should see fit to remove you from it or remove the difficulty from you. That is part of remaining faithful. Many times in my life, I've wanted to get out. Many times in my life, I've wanted to get out from underneath the difficulty and the pressure of ministry. It would just be easier to get another job. Don't you know how these people are, Lord? Of course he does, because he knows how I am too. You want to get out. Some of you are in a difficult situation in your marriage and you say, you know, this isn't worth it. I just want to get out. But faithfulness is seeing it through to the end and trusting that God will be pleased and honored, and that the value and the worth of his commendation towards you in heaven is worth remaining faithful until the end and doing it his way. Faithfulness, enduring suffering as a good soldier of Christ Jesus. Listen, soldiers don't have an easy time. I grew up on the West Coast out in California. That's where my family is today. I met my wife in college. I probably shouldn't give this illustration under the category of suffering, should I? Meeting my wife, suffering. That's not to be put together yet. I met my wife in college up in Virginia, and we ended up down here in Augusta. What's interesting is how things have come full circle, because when my dad was in the Army, he spent some time here at Fort Gordon, and it just so happened that here we are so close now. So that was back in the 1960s, a long, long time ago. But I've known enough about service, and many of you have served our country and served our country well, to know that being a soldier is not an easy task. There are many grueling, difficult things. They don't send you out into the field and you stay in the Holiday Inn Express with Belgian waffles for morning breakfast. And you're out in the field. You're crawling on your hands and knees. You've got enemy fire or simulated enemy fire coming over your head. You're trained in hand-to-hand combat. It's hard. Listen, Jesus never said, if you follow me, it's going to be easy. In fact, if people tell you, as long as you have faith and follow Jesus, everything will be good with you. If people tell you that, they're selling you something. That's not in the Word. Jesus said, in this world you will have tribulation. Didn't he say that? But be of good cheer, I've overcome the world. In other words, following Jesus Christ is not the easy path. That's why he said, if anyone wants to follow me, let him deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow after me. Listen, this whole soft sell idea of I'm going to live for Jesus and everything's going to be easy. Finances are going to all work out perfectly. My kids are all going to love God and everything's going to be easy and nothing's going to go wrong in my life. That's nonsense. This is a hard world. You have a target on you. The enemy, Satan himself, is like a roaring lion prowling about seeking whom he may devour. And he wants you and he wants your family. It's hard. To follow Christ means you must endure and not give up. Some of you here, you came in this morning, you haven't told anyone this, but you came here this morning and you thought, this is the last place I want to go, not because of anyone here necessarily, but your heart wasn't into this. You came because you're supposed to come, but this morning you came with a great deal of pain and difficulty and struggle and trouble, and some of you came in thinking, I don't know if I want to do this thing, this Christianity, this Christ following, this life anymore. And I want to encourage you to remain faithful to Jesus Christ, who has conscripted you, who has called you to be one of his. And in the end, it will be worth it. When we see him face to face, when we see his beauty and his glory, and when we see his nail-scarred hands, you'll see the suffering you endured was worth the suffering and worth all of the pain. And when you see his nail-scarred hands, you'll see that the suffering you endured was nothing compared to him, and his grace is sufficient. Today I want to encourage you to remain faithful by enduring. And it's a command. You must remain faithful. You must endure as a good soldier of Christ Jesus. We're his. Here's the thing. We're not our own. We're soldiers of Christ Jesus. We've been bought with a price. I don't belong to myself anymore. I don't call the shots. It's not my life to determine what I'm going to do and what I'm not going to do. We are Christ's and his alone, suffering as a good soldier of Christ Jesus. The second characteristic of a good soldier of Christ Jesus is found in verse 4. And we're moving quickly, so I hope that you'll listen quickly. Verse 4. No soldier gets entangled in civilian pursuits. What is he talking about here? He's talking about this word called devotion. God is calling us to a heart full of devotion. We might say dedication, devotion, an intense loyalty. And notice he uses once more the language of a soldier. No one engaged in warfare, no soldier goes to battle, is in active duty. No soldier gets entangled in civilian affairs. What is he saying? Can you imagine a soldier in the middle of the battle? I mean, the tracer fires are going. Okay, that's just to wake you up in the back. You were sleeping. No, you're in the middle of a battle, and the soldier's like, oh, I think it's my phone. Just a minute. Oh, hey, sweetie. What you doing? Yeah, you doing good? Things are good? Oh, hey. Wait. Yeah, oh, no, yeah, no, no, don't worry about the sounds. No, no, it's just, they're just, it's just, IEDs going off. Don't worry about that. You're in the middle of a warfare. You don't get distracted with the other things in this life. You keep the main thing the main theme. You keep the focus. That's devotion. That's dedication. Loyalty to Jesus Christ. What is he talking about? Well, listen, there are a lot of things in this life. There are a lot of things in this life that will keep you distracted. They're going to keep your attention away from Jesus Christ. They're going to pull loyalty from and devotion from Jesus and put them on the things of this world. The nicer cars, the nicer houses, the better clothes, the affirmation of people, the nice words that people will say to you. And very quickly we begin to move in our devotion to saying, to the admonition of Christ where he says, well done, and we want to hear other people say, well done. And our hearts move away from devotion to Jesus Christ. We begin to put our loyalties on things of the world. They entangle us. In fact, the word that Paul uses is the word entangled. It's the word to intertwine. Now, our brother mentioned I have 5 children. Isn't that amazing? Some of you laughed. Some of you said a prayer for me at the moment when you heard 5 children. Oh, let's pray for him. Have mercy, Lord. Now, I have 5 children. 4 of them are girls. Even our brother over here saying, let's lay hands on him at this point, all right? 5 of them are girls. So my oldest is in college, and my youngest is 4. That's a spread right there. And this is why I have no hair, see? Now, what I do know about hair, though, is because I have 4 girls in the house, I have learned to braid hair. All the ladies would be proud of me. All the guys are thinking, why are you doing that? I don't understand. Well, it's survival skills. When you have 4 girls, you just have to divide and conquer. So I've learned to braid hair. You know what braiding hair is, right? You take one piece and you weave it into another, and you weave that second piece and first piece into a third piece, and you weave it all together so it's entangled. And to try to get that separated means a whole lot of pulling and ripping, trust me, and crying. Paul uses the exact Greek word for entanglement for the word braid. In ancient Greek literature, to braid the hair would be to entangle. Paul says, don't get so wrapped up, so entangled, so weaved into the things of this life. Listen, some of you have been so consumed with getting more, more. I've got to have more, better, bigger, more. And your mind thinks about what's that next purchase? What's that next thing? What's that next Amazon purchase? That's going to make me happy for the moment that I open it, and then it's gone. And you get entangled in the things of this life. How easy we are to be distracted from the main thing, which is worshiping Jesus Christ and making him known to the nations. Oh, I loved hearing the heartbeat of our worship leader this morning, directing our attention to the nations that need to hear about Jesus Christ. Those who have least heard the gospel most need it. And we can get distracted so much with our own lives, with our own problems, with our own concerns, that we fail to remember the gospel of Jesus Christ. And we can get entangled and trapped in those things. When I was in high school, I used to snorkel a lot. That's putting on the mask and the snorkel gear and going out and looking at fish and sea life, because I grew up near San Diego. And there's some beautiful places to see underwater sea life. And I remember a story that my best friend told me about his dad. His dad was a diver. He used to go off a little distance from the shore with the full gear on and go deep. Off the coast of Southern California, there are a lot of seaweed beds, kelp beds, and they're thick forests of seaweed. He said he was swimming around the kelp bed because that's where the fish often were. And as he was swimming, he noticed something that troubled him a little bit. In fact, immediately when he saw it, it kind of knotted him up in his stomach. He began to get sick because he thought, if this is what I think it is, this is bad news. He swam a little further into the kelp forest, into the big bed of seaweed, and he noticed that in there was a man. It was not moving. He got so entangled and so wrapped up in that kelp forest, and then panic. He must have panicked, lost his gear, his mouthpiece, sucked in water, and drowned, because he first was entrapped in his environment. My fear for us as Christians, and the greatest strategy of the enemy, is for us to be entrapped and entangled in the things of this life, so that we forget what our main purpose is. So God has called us to devotion. Thirdly, I want to emphasize and remind us this morning from this next verse of this third characteristic of being a faithful follower of Jesus Christ, and that is integrity. Integrity. In verse 5, he says, if anyone competes as an athlete or in athletics. He's not crowned unless he competes according to the rules. In other words, you can't just go out and do whatever you want if you're an athlete. You've got to follow the rules that you've agreed upon. That being the case, if we are followers of Christ and we're to be faithful, we've got to compete according to the rules. Now listen, the Bible's not just a book of rules. If we come to the idea that God's word is just a bunch of things for us to do, we might have missed out. This is God's way of communicating to us who he is, his great love for us, and all that he's done for us. But inside, it does give us instruction on how to live. And there ought to be integrity in our lives. Someone once defined integrity as doing what you would do, or living holy or purely even when no one sees you. When no one knows, when no one will know, do you still do that? Or are there compromises? See, integrity is following Christ faithfully even when no one might notice. And he mentions here that the one who competes in athletics is not crowned. Now, in Roman days, they would train for 10 months. They had a strict diet. They had to do all of these things. And then they would receive this crown, leaves that would be around their head. But the Bible says we are contending for an imperishable crown, a crown that does not fade away, not one with leaves that you hang up and it will turn brown in a week or two, but a crown that doesn't diminish. In 1 Corinthians chapter 9, some of you will be encouraged this morning. Listen to these words. Do you not know that those who run in a race, they all run, but only one receives the prize? Now, by the way, if you see me run, you should also run, because it means someone's chasing me. But spiritually, we're running a race. So he says we're all running, but only one wins. And everyone who competes for the prize is temperate. That is, they use self-control in all things. Now, they do it in order to obtain a perishable crown. But we, for an imperishable crown, one that doesn't fade away, it will last. Therefore, run this way, not with uncertainty. I fight not as someone who's beating the air. I'm not shadow boxing. But I discipline my body, and I bring it into subjection. Honestly, I'm convicted right now just by reading these verses. I bring my body into subjection so that when I've preached to others, I should not be disqualified. You've got to compete according to the rules. What is he saying? He's saying integrity must typify our lives. If you're a follower of Jesus Christ, there's nothing worse than saying, I'm a follower of Jesus Christ and living just like the world. People look at Christians and go, it's just a sham. You're just fake. There's nothing true or real about that. They call us hypocrites. But as we follow Christ, as his heart is our heart, and we live holy and faithful for him, then by God's grace, as he does that in us, with that integrity in us, we'll be found faithful. And then there will be a crown of righteousness that's reserved because we've loved his appearing, and a crown waiting for us. Many years ago, I heard a story about a high school athlete. He was on the track team, and the team was competing in a championship, and one of the guys on the team who had never run the 1 mile, four laps, you know, around the track. That's for those who have never run anything. It's four. You got to go four all the way. This guy who had never run the 1 mile, he said to the coach, "Hey, I've got it in me. I really want to run. I think I can win today." He was just really enthusiastic. So the coach said, "Well, no one else seems that excited about running." So he put him in the match. The gun fired. They began running. Man, this guy shot out like a cannon. He began to run. He was in the lead on the first lap when they came around at the start place. The second lap, he went all the way around. He was still in the lead. I mean, he was leaving people behind. The coach thought he had found a hidden treasure on his team. By the third lap, he was still leading by a pretty good distance. Now, this particular race course had a tunnel that ran underneath the bleachers, the stands where everyone was sitting. So on the third lap around, the whole crowd went into the tunnel underneath the bleachers. And the young man who had been leading the whole time, went into the tunnel with a good lead. When the crowd came out, however, of the tunnel, the crowd of runners, when they came out, this man was nowhere to be seen. I thought maybe he tripped and he fell, and so they were waiting until the last of the runners had come forward, but now they were coming around the bend and around the corner, finishing now what was going to be this was on the second leg of the race, and finishing now on the third leg when they came around, finishing and coming on to the fourth leg. Out of the tunnel now comes this runner who stayed an entire lap's length in the tunnel waiting for the crowd of runners to come. And now on this last leg of the race, he comes out running with enthusiasm as though he had run the whole race, and he crossed the line in first place. But do you think he was crowned the victor of that race? No, certainly not. An interesting idea, a good strategy maybe, but not so much, because he didn't compete according to the rules. What God's saying to us this morning from his word is that if you desire for God to look upon your life with pleasure, if you desire one day to stand before him in heaven and for him to say, "Well done, my good and faithful servant, enter into the joy of the Lord." If you in your heart desire for God to have pleasure upon you, you've got to be faithful to his word. You can't have it both ways. You can't live for the world and live for Christ. You've got to make your choice. Young man, young woman, this morning, you've got to make a choice. Am I going to be wholeheartedly following Jesus Christ, living in holiness with devotion and with integrity, or am I going to try to live with the pleasures of this world and have it both ways? You're going to be the most miserable person in this world. Listen, take it from some of us who are getting older now. Take it from some of us who have less hair. Take it from some of us who haven't turned our hair loose, but it's turned gray. Listen to the voices of experience. You can't live for Christ and live for this world. You've got to make a choice. This world's going to bring you heartache and pain. It's going to disappoint, and it's going to leave you empty. You're going to end up ravaged by the evil one, and you're going to be left empty-handed and wondered, why did I make these foolish choices? Choose today whom you're going to serve. And live for Christ with integrity. And finally, he mentions in verse 6 the illustration of a farmer. He says the hardworking farmer should be the first to receive or first to partake of the crops. In other words, the one with diligence. The last mark here in this passage, the last characteristic of a faithful servant is someone who's diligent. That is to say, they don't give up, they continue, they endure, but they keep on going. Listen, being a farmer is hard work. My wife's grandfather was a pastor and a part-time farmer. and listen, this man was a hard. When he was 75, he worked around me. I mean, he was very diligent. He kept going. He didn't give up. He didn't want his leisure or his ease. Listen, our lives seem long here and now. The difficulties that you're facing, the circumstances that you might be in, it seems like a long time. Some of you are thinking, this message, this sermon seems like a long time. This life seems long, but I want to tell you, compared to eternity, it is a dot on the timeline of history. Your life is just a speck of time compared to forever. Work hard now. Work hard for Christ now. Be diligent now. Do what will last and what will count now. Do what in eternity, with what forever will be understood as lasting. Work hard for Christ now. Tell people about Christ now. Listen, you never know how long they're going to be in your path. Maybe for just a short period of time, and then they're gone. Tell people at your school, at your workplace, in your home, in your neighborhood, at your places of business. Tell them about Christ. Work for his kingdom now. And God promises that you'll receive a reward. That farmer is going to be the first to partake of the crops. About 3 or 4 years ago, actually 5 or 6 years ago, I began a garden on the side of my house. I have a little, about 15 meters by 30 meters of distance where I have an area to make a garden. And the first few years, I was really diligent. I mean, I worked really hard at it. And I received an amazing produce, a bumper crop, tomatoes and corn and many other things. It was great. But I worked hard at it. I was so excited. I would go out. I planted some watermelon. I would go out and in the morning before I went to church to study or to meet with people, I would go out and I would look and I saw a little baby watermelon. I was so excited. I can't tell you. It's silly. I know. I was excited about the baby watermelon. And the next day it was just a little bigger. And after rain, it was a little bigger. I wanted to pet it. You know, you're doing good. Keep going. It was like my baby, you know, it was growing, and every day, weeks, 2 weeks, 3 weeks passed, and I was anticipating having a great meal when that watermelon, and then as it grew, it was about this big. It was about 2 or 3 days from being picked, and we had a huge rain. I mean, a downpour. It rained all night, all day, and that watermelon received so much moisture, just poof, it just split wide open. My baby! It was so disappointing. I worked so hard, but I didn't get to receive of the share of the crop. But listen, God's promises towards you are not that way. He promises if you faithfully serve Him, if you faithfully, diligently, with hard work, with great ardor, with great diligence, work to serve Him, God promises in the kingdom to come, in heaven, there'll be great reward. And the question really is, are you going to believe God is true, or is God a liar? Because if you believe God is true, you'll orient your life around Him. You'll turn your life toward Him and serve Him diligently, believing that the sacrifices that you make here and now will be worth it in heaven. Faithful follower of Jesus Christ. If you're to be found faithful, it will not be because of your own effort alone. In fact, to put it in context, if you read the next verse in 2 Timothy says, remember Jesus Christ, risen from the dead. All of these descriptions, the devotion that ought to be in our life, the integrity that ought to be in our life, the diligence that ought to be in our life, the endurance that ought to be in our life, all of these markers of a faithful servant of God are not possible except the grace of Jesus Christ living and working through you. So if you find yourself lacking, you say, I haven't been very diligent for the Lord. My integrity, oh my goodness, I would hate for anyone to know what's really going on. If you find yourself saying, you know, my heart really is going out to the affections of this world, and I'm not living faithfully for Christ. If you find yourself wanting to give up and give in to temptation, give in to the things of this world. If you find yourself wanting to remain a part of this world with ties too tightly and intertwined, then you need to call out for the grace of the Lord Jesus. Christ, would you change my heart? Would you do a work in me so that my desires line up with your word? Because I've tried to do this myself and I've failed. I've tried to endure and I still want to give up. I've tried to remain in integrity, but I still have that sin struggle. I've tried in all of these areas, but I'm still having great difficulty, and I don't know if I can do this. You need to call upon Christ because His grace is sufficient for you. Here's what Scripture says. He who began a good work in you, Philippians 1:6, will be faithful to complete it until the day of Christ Jesus. That's a promise. He will be faithful to complete it. As you remain in Him, He will be faithful to complete it until the day of Christ Jesus. Here's what I invite you to do. Would you join me in a time of prayer? Would you just bow your heads right where you are, and just in reverence to the Lord, and just closing your eyes just so that it's not a distraction for you? If you'll just begin praying to the Lord at this time, maybe God's convicted you of something right now in your heart. There's sin you need to confess. Confess that right now. Just be obedient. Just confess that. Maybe there's a loyalty to this world that you have found yourself, your heart going after the things of this world. Your mind often thinks about all of the stuff of this world, but your mind doesn't often think about the things of heaven, the things that will last. Perhaps this morning there's an integrity issue in your life. You've been claiming to follow Christ, but your life doesn't match up, line up to that, and you need to confess it today. And you need to repent. The mercy of God is great for you. Maybe you're in a relationship that's not godly, and it's time to cut that off. Maybe you're in a practice that's not holy and it's tearing your soul apart. You need to confess that and turn from that. Talk to a trusted Christian leader. Maybe you find the desires of this world and the affections of the things of this life so captivating to you, they have a grip on your heart. And you need to ask God, oh God, in these moments, would you take any allegiance to this world away from me? And may my total loyalty and allegiance be for you and you alone. Perhaps you've been putting all of your effort into the things of this world, into building a kingdom here, but not a kingdom that will last. And this morning you need to say, oh Jesus, I want my life to count for more than just the here and now for the moment. I want it to last for eternity. Oh God, give me the sight to see what really counts and matters. As the Spirit of God convicts you, I want to pray over you and pray for you. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, risen from the dead, who offers us the hope of the gospel of Christ, who suffered in our place, took our punishment for us, so that we might have everlasting life. God, in His name I come, and I ask on behalf of these followers of Christ that You would give them grace, grant them grace to remain faithful to You, strong in You, full of good courage, living for what really counts in eternity. Lord, I pray that you would break any chain, any bonds to this world until only Christ remains. Lord, I pray that today in these moments, sin would be turned from, Christ would be worshiped. Those who don't know You personally would come to faith. Those who have looked at this list of things that describe a faithful servant and said, I'm none of those things. God, today they would come and say, I want to follow You, Christ, for the first time. I want to live for You. I want to know You. I want this to be true of my life. For those who've been struggling for many years, God, I pray today would be the day of victory for them in Christ once and for all. And may we be found faithful for You, for Your name, for Your glory. For the honor of Christ, we pray. Amen.
Let's all stand for our closing song.
Man of sorrows, Lamb of God, by His own betrayed, the sin. Silent as He stood, silent as He stood, accused, beaten, mocked, and sworn, bowing to the Father's ear, He took. Oh, that rocky cross. Now my debt is paid. It is paid in full by the precious blood that my Jesus spilled. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me. Whom the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. Now my debt is paid. It is paid in full by the precious blood that my Jesus spilled. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me. Whom the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. Oh, that wrong you broke, my salvation. Clear your love, pour it out, it over me. And now my soul cries out, hallelujah, risen honor all to thee.
See the stone.
The stone has rolled away. Behold the empty tomb.
Come on, church.
And hallelujah, God be praised. He's risen from the grave. Oh, that rolling cross, my salvation. Risen honor unto thee. Risen honor unto thee.
Amen. To close out, we're going to recite the Lord's Prayer together. Let's begin. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. You are dismissed.
And all that wrong in growth.